Okay. Good afternoon, and welcome to the session, When Privacy Meets Populism, How People Are Influencing the Data Debate. This session is a panel, so let me introduce you to the moderator, Julie Brill, Corporate Vice President at Microsoft. Thank you. Please.
Thank you so much. Welcome, everybody. This is going to be a really exciting discussion. We have here two incredible superstars in the privacy world. Just a brief background of who I am. Yes, I am Corporate Vice President of Microsoft. I am its Chief Privacy Officer, and I run Global Privacy and Regulatory Affairs for Microsoft. And I was an FTC Commissioner prior to that for 6 years. And then prior to that, I spent 20 years in state government running privacy, competition, and consumer protection programs, including leading the National Association of Attorneys General Privacy Working Group. But I have here with me two people who, in most circles, need absolutely no introduction, certainly no, in privacy circles, policy circles, and political circles. But let me at least give them their due. Helen Dixon, over here far to my left, is the commissioner, of the Irish Data Protection Commission. She's been the commissioner since 2014. Within her jurisdiction are many of the very large US tech companies who have their main establishment in Ireland. And as a result, Helen is probably considered by many people to be the lead regulator in Europe with respect to the tech industry. And then to my immediate left is Alastair Mactaggart, who is neither a lawyer nor a politician, and yet in many ways has been one of the most influential people in the privacy space in the United States. Alastair, of course, was very involved in doing an initiative, which then turned into California's CCPA, the California Consumer Privacy Act, and now he is working even more and doing more to deal with privacy laws in California by launching yet another initiative, which is known colloquially as CCPA 2.0, but has a more formal name, which Alastair will tell us all about. Before we get started, I just wanted to let you all know that we're going to do something a little bit different for questions this time. Rather than have you come up to the microphone at the end and ask a question or two, please go to my Twitter account, which is at Julie S. Brill. That's Julie S. for Simone, Brill, B-R-I-L-L. And you'll see that I've posted a call for questions. We're going to have someone who works very closely with me, Katie Sills. She's sitting in the front. She will be looking at my Twitter feed, and she will bring up to me two or three questions coming from the Twitter feed. So please go and ask your questions. You can do it now, or you can wait a little while the conversation gets going. But you want to do it within about 30 minutes so we can look at all the questions together. Okay. So there's a lot of discussion about how people do feel about privacy in the United States and of course around the world. Pew came out with a very influential report back in November, which indicated, to the surprise of some people, but not to the surprise of many of us who've been doing privacy for a long time, that actually the vast majority of Americans care deeply about privacy. They're concerned about how their data is collected and used. 7 in 10 Americans say they feel their personal information is less secure now than it was 5 years ago. And more than 8 in 10 Americans say they feel very little or no control over the data that's collected and used about them by the government or by industry. So, turning to our illustrious panelists, Alastair, you've done some polling in California, both to prepare for your work on the initiative, but also just to understand how Californians feel about privacy. How has public sentiment that you have learned about through your polling driven your work here in California?
Well, it was sort of critical. I think Speaker Pelosi is fond of quoting Lincoln about public sentiment being everything. And so before we even engaged in the journey at all in 2017, we did polling because there was no point in trying to tilt at windmills. And we found that people cared a lot about privacy. And that, I think, has just gotten stronger as the last couple of years have gone by and more data breaches and people becoming aware of what's happening to their information. And so our current, again, before we did the second initiative, which we're doing right now, also went out and polled. And in June, I think the numbers, we polled about 800 people. They were in the 93% range for most of the stuff we were talking about now. I mean, then we did another poll around 88. But these are numbers which the pollsters just say you don't ever see in California. This is sort of like, you know, should there be human trafficking or not, kind of those types of numbers. Which, by the way, was always one of my thoughts about if I was going to get into this against very large companies, we would need to have numbers of that type. So we're very high numbers. The purpose limitation, storage limitation, data minimization, all that stuff is off the charts.
So interesting. And again, like I said, many people, you know, used to say privacy is dead. People don't care about it. My experience and our experience has been very different as well. Helen, along sort of the same lines, how does public opinion affect the work of enforcement agencies in Europe around privacy? You run an enforcement agency, you're part of a board where all the European Union's enforcement agency leads participate. How are you seeing public opinion affect your work?
So leaving aside, say, surveys like Pew or the polls that Alastair has referred to in very pragmatic terms, as a data protection authority in the EU, we have to care very precisely and deeply about what individual members of the public think about their data protection or their privacy rights. And that's because EU data protection authorities have an obligation to handle every individual complaint from anyone who considers that their data protection rights may be infringed. And in the EU, the legislation that we have, the General Data Protection Regulation, it covers personal data processing in every context, so not just in consumer contexts. So for example, since the GDPR came into application, we've had quite a number of complaints to my office from individuals who are essentially seeking to defect from the Catholic Church. And very creatively, they want to use their right of erasure under the General Data Protection Regulation to seek deletion of their personal data from sacramental registers in the church. And this is now an investigation that my office has opened and requires us to look at canon law and sets down some complexities. So in terms of, aside from those creative uses of the GDPR, in terms of what individuals and the public complain about, it's very often issues that are very directly personal to them. So we've a lot of complaints that we deal with from employees of an organization that make a complaint against their employer or typically their former employer if they've been let go. And so usually what they do is they make an access request using their access rights under the GDPR, seeking copies of emails between the HR manager and their direct manager and whatever else they think may lead to evidence that they were mistreated or constructively dismissed. And this becomes then a battleground. So yes, what individual members of the public think and what their views are has to matter deeply to our office because we have to handle the individual complaints. But it's also true that what we talk about in an academic sense and what the media often talks about as the critical issues in privacy and data protection aren't particularly reflected in the complaints that the public bring forward. And it struck me when Alastair was talking about the poll and people say that they care deeply about privacy. We know as well that academics have identified this issue of the privacy paradox, where everyone, when surveyed, says they care deeply about privacy but behaves in a different way then. And that may have lots of causes in that we often have no choice because there isn't enough choice in the market in terms of how we do behave. But all that goes by way of saying that while what the public thinks and what's important to them absolutely counts, as data protection authorities and enforcers, we also have to look more broadly at what the important systemic issues that the public are perhaps unable to identify are and keep an eye on those as well.
Sure.
Can I just add, I think what Helen just said is so important that people care, but when they're confronted with a system where they don't think there's anything they can do,
right,
they just, I think they resign themselves to, you know, suffering through the lack of privacy because there's nothing they want to use the service. Mm-hmm. And then the other thing I'd say about public sentiment, which was interesting for us, there was a real tipping point with Cambridge Analytica. Mm-hmm. That was a huge moment where we went from being kind of crazy to, oh, that's what you're dealing with. Mm-hmm. And really that was a sea change for us as we went through the process.
Oh, wow, super interesting. Our experience, which I mentioned briefly a moment ago, you know, we offer GDPR rights globally. We have a dashboard where anyone can go around the world and interface with their data. And at this point in time, 38 million people around the world have gone to the dashboard. Individuals have gone to the dashboard. And you can say, look, given the number of people in the world and given the number of people who Microsoft might have some information about, that seems like a small percentage. But actually, what's really interesting in my view is that out of those 39 million, about a third of them are Americans. So what that says to me is this meme that, again, Americans don't really care about privacy is belied by the fact that they do want to see their data. They want to go to the dashboard. They want to touch it. They want to be able to access it or even just know that they can access it by putting in their name and seeing what we have, what kind of data we might have about them, which doesn't diminish at all your point, Helen, that people are still deeply worried when they know about it, about what's going on behind the scenes by third-party data collectors, and that's just something that you're not going to necessarily hear complaints about because
exactly.
People don't know what's going on. Yeah. Helen, let me ask you this. So GDPR, the European Union's General Data Protection Regulation, has been in effect around 21 months, about, you know, almost 2 years now. Of course, it follows on, you know, a 20-year history of Europe having a different type of law in place, or the member states having laws in place under the European Union's Data Protection Directive. What do you think the effect of GDPRs coming online, one law, more or less, for all of the member states, what effect has that had on Europeans' views about privacy?
So I think there was a big buildup to the GDPR, and Alastair mentioned Cambridge Analytica, and of course that story broke in March 2018 in the lead up to the GDPR and gave a real boon and a bounce to attempts by data protection authorities like my own office to drive awareness of data protection rights and obligations on organizations. So I think the GDPR has captured people's imagination. On the one-year anniversary of application of the GDPR in May of last year, the EU Commission, which is the policy maker in the EU for data protection laws, it ran a Eurobarometer survey or commissioned a special Eurobarometer survey, and it found that 70% of people had an awareness of the GDPR in the EU. About the same number could cite at least one right that they were entitled to exercise. Maybe disappointingly, only 3 out of 10 could name all of the rights that they could exercise. And a high enough percentage, about 57% to 60%, knew about their national data protection authority and the ability to bring a complaint. So there's been a high level of awareness. There's increasing interest on the part of individuals to exercise the rights, as evidenced by your own experience in Microsoft. And then correspondingly, a big increase in the number of complaints that individuals are bringing to offices like mine. So we, in the last calendar year of GDPR for 2019, handled almost 7,000 individual complaints of varying levels of complexity. But I think to swing back to the conversation we were just having, I think individuals in many cases, based on focus groups that my office has brought together, are still a little bit confused about how and when to exercise their rights. They feel they should be worried because a lot of the negative rhetoric and media reporting, particularly around technology companies, they feel they should be concerned and caring about their data protection rights, but they're not always sure exactly what responsibility rests on their own shoulders. So I think we've a way to go in terms of communicating better with individuals what the harms and risks are and what their own role in protecting their own rights is.
Interesting. Alastair, do you see any effect when you're thinking about and talking to people about legislation, here in California or in Washington, D.C. Do you think that GDPR and, you know, coming online and being effective in the European Union, but affecting any company that has data about Europeans, wherever they're located, do you think that GDPR has had an effect in the United States in terms of policymaking?
Well, I think certainly for us, GDPR was everything, because absent GDPR, you know, we would have been screaming into the wind these crazy nut bars like, what's this data stuff and who are you people? And by the way, you're going to kill the Californian golden goose. You're just insane people. And this will be one more wacky California initiative we can just for sure crush. And I think absent GDPR, the tech companies who all contributed to the campaign anyway in February of 2018 would have been emboldened and would never have let it get to where we got to in June when we passed the law. They would have said, no, we're going to bomb these guys into obliteration in the general election. What happened with GDPR is we could say, look, we're not even asking for what GDPR does. So you can't say, Facebook, that you can't produce the data. Or you can't say, Google, that you can't, you know, delete the data, because you're already doing it. And that made us appear much more reasonable. So I honestly, without GDPR, we would never have been able to do what we did, what we were able to do.
That's really interesting. And then circling back to Europe, look, there's a lot going on in with the new European Commission that has come online, or that is now been formed in December. Lots of initiatives and new policies that are starting to get articulated. Do you, Helen, see GDPR and, you know, now having had 21 months of experience with it, what effect is that law and the fact that it has global impact having on the European Commission's view and or the European public writ large with respect to policy, with respect to regulating big tech, with respect to regulating US tech firms?
I mean, it's worth repeating, we are only about 22 months into the application of the GDPR, and I think it's a long-term project. So I think it's probably too early to take the learnings from the GDPR in very high-level terms at this point. For example, in Article 97 of the GDPR, there's a requirement for the EU Commission, the policymaker in the EU, to review the harmonization elements across the EU of the GDPR after 2 years of application. So that review is coming up now. And various quarters who've made submissions to the EU Commission have suggested, partly influenced by the very useful debates that are happening in the US around state laws and a federal law, have suggested wholesale changes, potential improvements to the law. And I think what's likely to be the case is that the EU Commission will say, we've got a new comprehensive law, we've got to stick with it for a period of time to see what it can deliver, in particular in enforcement terms. So the data protection authorities have yet to fully ramp up and deliver on cross-border enforcement across the EU under the GDPR. So it's early days, and there's lots of good things happening under the GDPR, but we have to let it deliver on its full potential or fail to deliver on its full potential, and then start looking at amending if required.
One thing I think I'd add about the effect on policy here, I think initially you saw this story being told in certain sectors saying, oh, this is just Europe trying to take a bite out of the American tech firms, and this is them trying to be anti-competitive and trying to get back at our success. And I think what's happened in the last couple of years is there's a sort of realization in policymakers' views that, oh, actually, this is kind of important stuff. Maybe they just were ahead of us.
Right.
You know, and it's gone from being like, oh, this is just the France trying to, you know, make our firms less successful, to like, maybe we got to catch up to them.
Right. That's been my experience as well. And I think Cambridge Analytica, which you both have talked about, was part of that paradigm shift. But recognizing that, you know, people do really care about
right.
this. And we actually
right.
need to do something, because their people are feeling out of control. And so we
right.
need to give them back some control. Helen, I'm curious, though, you know, from my vantage point, 6,000 miles away from Brussels, But reading a lot of, you know, various publications, it seems to me that European policymakers are proud of what they've done with respect to GDPR. It's driving conversation in state capitals and in Washington, D.C., and frankly, around the world, in Brazil, in Venezuela, lots in Africa, lots of jurisdictions, Japan, South Korea, all over the world. And so it's a little, you know, just taking a step back, I'm wondering if you think that if you are also seeing, being much closer, that policymakers in Europe see GDPR as a success, maybe not, maybe still unfinished, as you're saying, it's early, but it certainly has had an impact, and in that, by that measure, a success, and maybe thinking that, okay, now we're going to take step two, whether it's going to be in digital services or whether it's going to be in competition or any of the other areas that the new commission is talking about.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose it's worth bearing in mind in terms of whether the policymakers are proud or not, or whether we ultimately measure it as a success. It's worth bearing in mind that the EU has had a comprehensive data protection law for over 25 years. We had the 1995 Data Protection Directive with a lot of the same principles that applied in the EU. And in the EU as well, we have a Charter of Fundamental Rights that is basically part of the DNA of every EU person. And within that suite of rights that individuals have, they have under Article 7 a right to privacy, and they have under Article 8 a specific right to have their personal data protected. And then under the Lisbon Treaty in the EU, data protection is specifically called out. So there's a huge imperative and a requirement for us to have a robust data protection law in the EU to give effect to the rights that EU persons have. In terms of its export, and a lot of journalists have written about this thing called the Brussels effect, it is clear it has been a success as an export. We're seeing GDPR type laws, I think you mentioned Brazil, appearing in many countries around the world. From our point of view, this is hugely positive, particularly when you're talking about regulating global big tech companies. We need more alignment in terms of the principles that are recognized as being important globally. We need, as individual data protection authorities in the US, in Brazil, in Ireland, to be able to implement joint enforcement actions and to realize synergies in terms of using our resources to tackle issues. So I think that is something that's very positive, that there has been an export effect. I think, again, as I said, it's very positive that there are some unique debates happening and thoughtful debates around state laws and a potential federal law in the US. It doesn't have to be a GDPR law. There are lots of defects, undoubtedly, in the GDPR, and I think it's worth learning the lessons of what can be done better now with laws that succeeded elsewhere.
If I could just, sure, one please. Thing about that I think is really important, what you're saying is there's a journey element to it. And you know, there are a lot of people who like to criticize something because it's not perfect. And our attitude is, you know, a journey of 1,000 miles, you gotta begin somewhere, one single step, right? And so think about, I've gotten some criticism because this current initiative is 50 pages long. And people say, oh, this long, it's cumbersome. And I say, okay, just think, the two things that jump out of my mind are, one, think of antitrust legislation, right? It started in 1870, you know, 150 years later, we're still talking about what's the right, where's the line? Where's the line between too much competition, I mean, too much, you know, monopoly and not enough competition? And so we've just entered a new world of privacy. And privacy, by the way, is not just privacy, it's how these giant companies compete and grow. Because our data, as we all know, is sort of the raw material of so many of these companies. And so it's entirely appropriate to me that this is going to be a journey that is going to be going on for hundreds of years, as long as there's, you know, sort of this society keeps on going. And I think that, you know, the income tax showed up 100 years ago, and we're still figuring out what the income tax code is. And yes, people come up with tax shelters, and then the legislature intervenes and says, okay, that's not appropriate anymore. That same analog is going to happen in privacy and will happen, and that's just a normal, healthy process of legislation getting made.
And it's a process like in the competition area, which actually began in the states also, right, in the United States. I mean, states were enacting what one might call mini Sherman Acts before Congress got involved. So we're going to take a quick break, audience check-in. I want to know, can just raise your hands, how many of you are privacy people in the audience? Oh, a lot. How many of you are security people who don't really do privacy? Yeah, so we do have a lot of privacy people in the audience. That's awesome. How many of you do not know what the California Consumer Privacy Act is? We've got very few. Wow. That's awesome. Look at the impact you've had. That's awesome. How many of you don't know what GDPR is? Wow.
I win.
You that's great. Okay, because now I think for the two of you who raised your hand, you're not sure about CCPA, what, California Consumer Privacy Act, come up afterwards. I'll be happy to fill you in. But I don't need to ask Alastair to describe it because everybody knows what it is, which is really remarkable. Alastair, I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit. I know you've testified in the Senate. I've testified. Helen's testified. We've all been talking to people in Washington, D.C., policymakers, about the journey, what they can do to be inspired by GDPR and develop a really good, robust law in the United States, taking the good pieces and maybe not the pieces that don't work in the United States. But what has been your experience with the impact of CCPA, the California Consumer Privacy Act, in Congress with respect to developing a federal law?
Well, so I've been out in D.C. a fair amount, as you said, and it's interesting. One comment that I've heard variations on, but basically the same message from tons of members and staff has been, you know, for 25 years, big tech has been in here saying, don't mess with the golden goose. Don't, you know, self-regulation is the best regulation. You guys are too stupid to understand what we do, so don't mess up. And now, since CCPA passed, they're in this, the same people are in our office saying, we need preemption right now. We've got to have a federal law. It's really important, and you've got to basically preempt California. And I think, so at the very least, California, the passage of the law has started a debate in Congress. And now you're aware there's a whole bunch of bills different members have introduced. I'm not sure that anyone are necessarily getting anywhere fast, but there is a discussion. And I think that one of the big issues, or a couple of big issues, one is we have a private right of action here in California around negligent data breach. Very hard to see Congress passing anything with a private right of action, which means by definition, if they do, it'll be a weaker law than California. We in California, our representatives represent 20% of the House Democratic Caucus, plus the Speaker. Hard for me to see that the California delegation will allow something weaker than California's law to preempt. And on the subject of preemption, let me just say, like, as an American, I think all Americans deserve good data, privacy, and I would welcome a national law. And the two other major national privacy laws are GLBA for finance and HIPAA for health. Now, both of those laws are floors, not ceilings. They let the states go further, and here in California, we have laws in both industries that go further. Now, tech's argument has been, oh, we can't possibly comply with 50 different state laws. It'll be a disaster. You'll put us out of business. And my answer is, the last time I checked, there were banks in all 50 states, and there were hospitals in all 50 states. I think this is just, I think what it is, it's just a red herring that tech goes to Congress and says, we desperately need preemption, and please make all the bad stuff go away. Make this look good for consumers, but actually let me not have to really change how I do business. Let me say, I shouldn't say tech, because not all tech is monolithic. And for example, what Microsoft did when they said we're gonna give CCPA rights to all the country, that to me is what has to happen, what will happen. If you're a consumer company, you say, by the way, your cell phone, your brother-in-law in California can have certain rights around your cell phone data, but you in New York can't, how long is that gonna last? That's untenable for consumer-facing companies. So I think CCPA, to answer your question, has started a debate in Congress. I don't know where it ends. Mm-hmm. Do I think there should be a national privacy law? Yes. Do I think there will be? Eventually. Mm-hmm. But also, you could imagine a world where in the early 70s, we in California started to take control of our air quality. And remember, we're the fifth largest economy in the world. So when we said, hey, here's how it's going to be for air, the car manufacturers are like, okay, well, I guess we want to sell cars in California. And I can definitely see that happening here in California, where we set the national standard, because guess what? You can't get anything done through Congress. Mm-hmm. So that's what I would say there.
And it's also, the CCPA has also been a great motivator to other states. Both some state, you know, there's about, I think, 20 states that are looking at different, what we call sort of broad-based horizontal laws, unlike the financial privacy laws or the health privacy laws involving health institutions, which is known as HIPAA. Washington State has one, but New York has one. There's a lot of state activity right now, too. Mm-hmm. Helen, you mentioned before that you, as someone who is regulating tech and is regulating not just tech, but because in some ways every company is going to be a data company, every company is going to have to be dealing with these issues. You know that you, as a regulator of data protection in Europe, appreciate seeing other countries looking to GDPR to try to create some sort of alignment, to try to create some kind of harmonization for global interoperability. So what is your view of what you're seeing in California in terms of helping with that effort or hindering that effort, as well as what you're seeing in Washington, D.C., understanding, as Alastair says, that we don't know whether anything will actually happen in Washington, but we're certainly seeing some activity. So how do you see all of that rolling up to your hope for continued sort of interoperability and some kind of harmonization?
From our point of view, it's all enormously positive. As I've said many times before, a key challenge for us in the EU, and particularly for the data protection authority that I head up, is that we're regulating, let's talk about internet platforms for a few minutes, internet platforms that are exported from the US, where some of the most brilliant innovations happen, but which are exported from a country where there is no data protection filter, there is no comprehensive horizontal law that in any way proscribes certain forms of personal data processing. So these platforms are exported without any filter at the moment. US companies are then trying to retrofit those services to comply with what was the 1995 directive and now the GDPR. And really, if you look at the principles that are now enshrined in the GDPR, in particular around data minimization and privacy by design and by default, retrofitting is never really likely to deliver on those principles. And they really need to start out the genesis of the engineering and design of those platforms and services into the future really needs to build in those principles at the start. Now, I know as a starting point, not all of those principles are exactly replicated in the CCPA and may not be if there is a federal law, but it's a good starting point that there is a law there, that there is some kind of filter that forces a recognition on the part of companies that are exporting their platforms globally, that personal data counts, that people have rights that they're entitled to exercise, and that people do care about those rights, and that soon it will be a business disadvantage to be seen not to be in compliance. So it's all positive from our point of view, but the more alignment over time, the better.
Yeah, yeah. There's nothing like having to provide the data that belongs to a particular individual to drive data hygiene, right? I mean, if you really are going to give access rights and deletion rights, it means you need to know where that person's data is. So it definitely does drive some of what you're talking about. Alastair, harmonization brings to mind adequacy decisions. How many know what I mean when I say an adequacy decision? All right. Okay, I think it's worth either you're explaining, why don't you go for it, what your view is about the possibility of California's law serving to drive this type of harmonization and perhaps even going so far as to enable an adequacy decision from the European Commission.
Sure. So adequacy is a concept in Europe under GDPR, which is kind of self-evident, right? It says you can't take the data from Europe where you have good privacy law and send it somewhere where there isn't privacy protection, because actually that would kind of you know, get rid of the whole point of it, right? Because data is very fungible. So you really, you can only send it to an area, to a place with a data protection regime that we, Europe, have deemed adequate, is what adequacy says. And interestingly, one of the things in GDPR is they allow for that to go to territories of countries. So they could say a territory is adequate. So look, there's a possibility, if this initiative, the second initiative that we're working on, there's a possibility that the EU might deem it adequate, but that's not really the reason we're doing this. The reason we're doing this is because it's the right thing to do, and it's because it's bringing us up to kind of the first world. Not that I think CCP isn't great, but when we first did it, we knew we were going to be in a big fight, and so we kind of were less aggressive than we could have been. Now we're kind of saying, if GDPR is up here, let's bring it right up here. And so we've taken the best parts that we think of GDPR. We have a certain difference of opinion around opt-in versus opt-out. But in general, we're trying to take the best parts of GDPR. And I think that's the right thing to do for consumers. There is a chance that at that point, if this does pass, that Europe could deem us adequate. We've already seen Mr. Giancarelli say so in public, that there's nothing in principle that would prevent a state of a country being deemed adequate. What that would do would be, it would allow data to be exported from Europe to California without really any constraint. So I think as a Californian, if you're a big company, if Microsoft's gonna put a data center somewhere, why wouldn't they put it in California? I think it's good for California, good for the Californian economy. And just getting back to the whole harmonization thing, I think, here's the thing, what you just said was really interesting about, you know, data hygiene, the laws promoting data hygiene. The point is, I don't think it really matters what flavor of data protection law you're talking about. At the end of the day, as a business person, what you really have to do is know where the data is, be able to find it, be able to produce it, know who within your company is seeing it. It's all kind of, it's sort of like occupational health and safety. You know, go back 150 years, no one cared about what happened to the workers. You know, you can go to Japan, you can go to Europe, you can go to, you know, here, but presumably in the mines, there's someone saying, is the air quality good? And they have different standards, but at the end of the day, it's all going to the same place. That's all we're doing here. So adequacy may indeed happen. I look on it more as we're all headed towards the same ultimate goal, which is protecting consumers and giving them some control over their data.
Cool. We're getting some great questions on Twitter. So if you want to, for those of you who came in late, if you go to Julie S. Brill, you'll see I posted a request for questions here. That's how we're going to do our Q&A today. So if you've got something else, cool. You want to just hand it to me?
No Twitter, sorry.
Okay, cool. Thank you. Oh, no Twitter. Wow. Okay. All right. It's for security reasons, okay? All right. Awesome. Okay. Let's turn a little bit to competition around privacy. Mm-hmm. We are definitely seeing, I think, some differentiation going on in the marketplace around privacy issues. I'm curious, from your vantage points, what are you seeing with respect to companies that are trying to drive their privacy messaging, and actually, more importantly than their messaging, their actual solutions to trying to deal with privacy issues? And where do you see that going in the near term?
Yeah, I mean, I think there is huge potential and a real hope that data protection will be a differentiator in the market. And probably a company like Microsoft is seeing this already. I think certainly in the business-to-business space, if you're going to be supplying software as a service to other organizations, if you can guarantee those organizations that you have baked in all of the GDPR obligations and capabilities to exercise rights and can effectively guarantee organizations that deploy your solution that they're not going to end up fined under the GDPR, then your product is going to differentiate itself. I think in terms of the market directly to consumers, it's going to be a little bit more slow moving, or it has been a little bit more slow moving, because we've seen browsers like Firefox and we've seen solutions like Brave in the marketplace, but the take-up isn't particularly high on them. So I think there has to come a point where the utility and convenience that Alastair was talking about earlier for users is there in the products that differentiate themselves in data protection terms, that using something that enhances your data protection isn't an extra effort that you're just not going to go to when it comes down to it. So I think it will happen, but it's a slower burn, it seems.
Interesting. Alastair.
Yeah, and I think that's one of the differences between CCPA and then CCPA 2.0 and GDPR. One of the, my convictions all along has been what we were trying to do was start an industry, And so one of the key differentiators at CCPA is we allow you, the consumer, to use a business to do the privacy work for you. And so all of the businesses covered by CCPA have to respect an authorized agent, whether it's a request to opt out, or it's a request to get your information. And the details have to be worked out how that's going to actually happen, so it does not a vector for fraud. But what it really is it's got to be easy. And that's why we have the do not sell button, don't sell my information. We're going to require it on every website. And that's why we are going to allow you to have someone else intercede for you. And what that really is going to mean is that your browser can do the work for you. Because if you're being able to set your browser to don't sell my information, you're going to require that the companies respect that signal. And I think that's going to be a big difference. I have a conversation every couple of days with some startup now saying, hey, we want to start up in this space. And I think it's slow getting going, but this went into effect in January. I think in California, we've started a privacy industry because I think there will be a Symantec or a McAfee of privacy, and there already are some big companies in privacy. And I think that's really going to, we've kickstarted that industry here.
So we've got some really interesting questions. I'm going to start with the non-Twitter person. Thank you for your question. I'll just read it, and then I want to put a gloss on it, if you don't mind. So I'm reading. HIPAA is well-intended and well-principled, but it's preventing epidemiology from accessing large sets of cancer data. Is there a concept of inverse privacy? Sets of human data important enough for humanity that the data must be public? What I will add to that is when I was a commissioner at the FTC, I had executives from the healthcare industry in particular, but not just them, come up to me and say, Julie, you have to get a regulation in place. You've got to get a law in place. We have so much data that will benefit humanity, but we can't use it because we don't know the rules of the road. We don't know what we can and can't do with it. Will you accept that as a friendly amendment? Okay, awesome. So, thoughts about, the role of a law to allow companies, whether they're healthcare institutions or nonprofits or even governments, to unleash the power of data, but in a respected way.
So that question particularly resonates with me because under the GDPR, there are types of derogations and exemptions that allow processing of personal data and special categories of personal data, like health data, if it's for scientific or archiving or research purposes. But typically those purposes then have to be set down in national law. So in the law to give further effect to the GDPR in Ireland, health regulations were introduced to deal with the area of health research. And clearly, despite attempts to consult on those regulations before they were enacted in Ireland, they've been something of a failure because they did exactly what you were talking about there. They prevented health research that should be happening. They prevented epidemiologists from accessing data because they set far too high an absolute bar around collecting consent in all sorts of scenarios where it simply wouldn't be practical or possible or in the interests of anybody, really. So those health regulations have had to be modified in Ireland, and the second pass at them, only 22 months into the GDPR, is now coming into effect. So it's a critically important area, and it's very easy to get it wrong by overemphasizing the data protection side and getting it wrong in terms of the bar that's to be set. The EU has recently announced something, and there's not very much detail available on it yet in terms of looking, you were talking about this earlier, Julie, in terms of looking at the next wave of legislation around digital and data in the EU. And they're talking about something called a data act that we anticipate is going to be something like your question anticipates, where rather than having a focus on data protection, it's going to be around identifying data that should be in the public domain and used for public good. So I hope that is the direction that it's going in.
Thoughts, Alastair?
Yeah, real simply, CCPA says de-identified information is not personal information. So there's really no restriction on it. And I guess my argument, or my question would be is, if it's de-identified, you should be able to use it for epidemiology or for healthcare studies. And if you need it to be identified, then I think anybody here would kind of want to know before their health information was being used. And this also leads me to one other observation. The reason I think states are so important as opposed to just a blanket federal law. The law of this country right now, since 1986, has been that if your information is over 180 days old, any law enforcement agency can go to the person who has the information and get it without a warrant. And why? Because in 86, no one thought this stuff was important. Yeah. Now that law, ECPA, they've tried to change it twice. It's passed out of the House of Representatives twice unanimously, both times failed in the Senate. It is almost impossible to get anything done in Washington. That's why we need state laws that can move so that if something needs to get changed, it can. But again, I don't think this is an issue for CCPA because de-identified information is not personal information.
Right. And what's so interesting, of course, is that there's a definition of de-identification in California's law, and then there's a definition in GDPR, and it's a pretty strict definition.
Yeah.
Anonymization, excuse me.
It has to be irreversible.
It has to be essentially under GDPR. You have to. It can't be a system or a technique that could be broken into, which is a very, very high bar to reach. Right. Okay. We have very few minutes left, right? 3 minutes? Yes. Okay. What I'd like to do is turn to your future predictions. So you each have 90 seconds. What are your top level, you can say, top three predictions for what people will care most about in the coming 2-3 years with respect to privacy?
So to put it in very high level and in data protection terminology terms, I think what they will care most about without being able perhaps to express it this way is privacy by design and default baked into any of the services or products that they use. You and I spoke on a panel yesterday evening, and the other panelist kept making analogies with product safety. And I think what individuals want in the future is not to have the anxiety about if they click OK, are they consenting to something that's not in their interests and is unsafe and is going to harm them. They want to be able to engage with the service and know that there is a minimum threshold that has been met in terms of, as I said, data protection by design and by default. And the other prediction I would have for the future is that we're going to get on top of the issues involved in the protection of children in particular from a data protection point of view. You've had your COPPA law here in the US. We are only now starting to recognize that children merit specific protections under EU law, and we need to work out what that means, and I think we will.
Interesting. Alastair, future.
Real quick, running out of time. I think people are going to get freaked out when you can put your glasses on and walk down the street and know a lot about individuals. That's gonna be a freaky world in society if I know what your mortgage is and how many kids you have and where you live. That's a world that's gonna unsettle people. I think we'll have more state privacy laws. I'm not optimistic about a federal law. Think about data breach, 2005. Here.
In California, 2000,
And then 2020, Alabama, last one. 50 different state of breach laws, and by the way, that's still working. But that might actually happen with privacy. And then my third would be November CCPA 2 passes.
There you go. All right. Well, please join me in thanking our panelists for a fabulous conversation. Thank you. Thank you.